giving us breath in our lungs, Father God. Yes. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. Okay, if y'all will tonight, just stand up. We're gonna do a little Friday night activity. I know most of y'all have been at work, or you have been at school, or maybe you've been at home cooped up. But just take a moment and just stretch out those arms to the heavens. Stretch out those arms to the heavens.
Hallelujah.
Come on, kids. Y'all do it too. Come on.
There's no age exemption.
Father God, we thank you for covering us with your blood right now, Father God. You just fall from the heavens tonight, Father God. We thank you for opening up the window of heaven, Father God, and pouring out upon your people tonight, Father. Lord, we thank you for your glory.
We thank you
for your presence here tonight, God, for stirring up an atmosphere of praise, for worship, to glorify your name, Father. We thank you for miraculous signs and wonders, Father God. We thank you for salvation. We thank you for healing, Father God. We thank you for doing a new thing here at Central Assembly tonight, God. We thank you for the new thing, for the new thing. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, come on, come on. Keep pressing.
Lift your voice. I want you to praise him. Come on, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Come on, praise. Jesus, we bless you. We bless you, Lord. We magnify you. Hallelujah. Now agree with me in prayer. Father God, we bind every principality and power. The rulers of the darkness of this region sent with an assignment against the lives of these people, against the purpose of this church. We bind that thing in Jesus' name, and we loose the power and the purposes of God to be manifested in every life, in every family, in every home, in the mighty name of Jesus. Hey, devil, you got no place here. Come on, come on. My God, my God, my God. Hallelujah. Radabase kelemende shelama rosa. Hallelujah. Now listen, this is not a Sunday morning service. This is Friday night. I want you to get wild and crazy. I want you to open up. Listen, I want you to open up your heart. And if you've never been filled with the Holy Ghost, you don't need nobody to lay hands on you. He's here. I got prayed for every service for 6 months, and I got filled back there all by myself on a pew on a Sunday morning. Come on. It's just about you yielding. I want you to give God permission to come in and do whatever he needs to do and wants to do in your life. Will you do that? Amen. Now, I'm going to make the introductions now because we're just going to hit the gas pedal and go. Come up here, the man and woman of God. I don't even know what to call you guys. My good friends, Pastor, Sister Cox, Ron and Suzanne Cox. Come on, give them a hand. Amazing stories that they've got, but more than anything, they've got a testimony of Jesus. It's not just about their story. It's about what Christ has done. And what he's done for others, he'll do for you. Amen. Stretch your hands out as we pray over this couple tonight. Father, I thank you that God, heaven is going to manifest tonight. And Lord, you're going to speak through and use this couple. I thank you for the gifting of God in their lives. I thank you, Lord, for the journey that you brought them through. And Holy Spirit, I thank you that because they've pressed on and they haven't given up, there is a supernatural anointing in their life to break yokes. So God, use them. Use them to lift up those hands that hang down. Use them to strengthen the feeble knees. Use them is my prayer today. We're going to give you thanks and praise. In Jesus' name, let the church say. Come on now, one more time, one more time. Give him a crazy praise.
We glorify you, Father. There is no one like you, God. hungry to come here on a Friday night. That's all I can say. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for meeting us where we are, God. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah.
No weapon formed against me will prosper. When darkness falls, it won't prevail. Because the God I serve knows only how to triumph. Yeah, yes, I know. Hallelujah. My God, yes, my God will never fail. Because I'm going to see your victory. I'm going to see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm going to see your victory. I'm going to see your victory. For the battle belongs to you,
Lord. Let's sing that again. Let's sing that again. Come on.
Because I'm going to see your victory. I'm going to see your victory. For the
Come on, come on, come on.
Break every chain.
Break every chain.
chain, break every chain, break every chain.
Are you in that army tonight?
Break every chain,
break every chain,
break every chain, break every chain.
To break every chain,
break every chain,
break every chain.
To break every chain.
You know, he is a chain breaker. He is the way maker. When there seems to be no way, he is the way. He is the truth, and he is the light. No one can go to the Father except through the Father. Yes. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We serve a big God. We serve a chain breaking God. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
To break every chain.
Break every chain.
To break every chain.
Break every chain.
Break every chain.
Every chain.
Break every chain. To break every chain.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's so much God wants to do here tonight, guys. There's so much God wants to do here tonight. Hallelujah. 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 Ruko shana na 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 ye. Hallelujah, Father.
Oh no, you've done it now. Gone against the king, gone against the crown. Oh no, you've done it now. Time to feel the fire. Come on. Spreading all around, how could he think he would stay down? Rumors spreading all around, he's nothing but a liar.
He's nothing but a liar, and we're gonna clean house right now. We're gonna clean house right now, because we don't have room for liars in this house. We don't have room for the enemy in this house. God, what you have been for our good, Father God, I pray that you just be glorified through it tonight, God. What the enemy has meant for our evil, turn into good tonight, Father.
Get up and
against, we shall prosper in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Awesome God. Hallelujah. He's an awesome God. He's an awesome God. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. Just stir up the atmosphere and begin to praise, begin to worship, begin to cry out. We cry out to you tonight, Father. Hallelujah.
I could hear the footsteps of my King. I could hear his heartbeat beckoning. In my darkest, he has set me free. Now I hear the Spirit calling me. He's calling, wake up, child. Such a time as this, he's calling, wake up, child. It's your time to shine, for you were born for presence of my King. I could hear the heartbeat beckoning. In my darkest, He has set me free. Now I hear the Spirit calling me. He's calling. Chains and breaking down the walls. Hallelujah. I can hear the Father when He calls. He is calling, wake up, child. It's your time to shine, for you were born for such a time as this. He's calling, wake up, child. It's your shake our nation. All we need is your love to captivate.
Come on, come on.
This is the anthem of our generation. Here we are, God. Shake our nation. All we need is your love.
Generation.
Here we are, God. Shake our nation. All we need is your love to captivate me. This is the anthem of our generation.
Beautiful among thousands. Of the King, don't sing it for anybody else.
Thank you, Jesus. I'd like to have all the meals up here, please. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. There's something about that name, church. I said there's something about that name. At the name of Jesus, one day every knee's going to bow, every tongue confesses. But today, sickness has got to bow at the name of Jesus. Come on. Come on now. The Bible says that in Isaiah, that with his stripes we are healed. Peter said, we, looking back from the cross, we were healed. So Pastor Mills and Sheila Mills, his son, her husband, is in, I guess, John Seeley now. They transported him to Seeley. He's on a ventilator, COVID, and not getting really good reports. That doesn't shake our faith, though. Whose report will you believe? We shall believe the report of the Lord. Now, you see, I don't think it's by accident that they're here, and we're concerned about Mike Mills, and we're gonna see God raise him up. But let me tell you something. Jesus never healed anybody because but just so that they could live a little bit longer before they died. Every person he ever healed was for the glory of the Father. Come on. That ought to do something to you. That ought to stir something in your heart. Jesus said, these are not my works, these are my Father's works. I'm only doing what I see the Father do. Come on. And every healing, every person he raised from the dead wasn't so that he could stop the crying eyes of the family. It was so Father could get glory. Sheila messaged the church today and asked if we could anoint her with oil and pray and believe God for Michael to be healed. Amen? I told her, I said, I don't think we believe in that around here. No, that's not what I told her. I not only told her, yes, we practice that, and here's why. James 5:17 says, are any sick among you, let them call for the elders of the church, and they will anoint them with oil. And the prayer of faith. You see, we want to put it all on God, but if the sick are not healed, it ain't his fault. my fault. It's your fault. So I came fully prepared to anoint you with oil. And driving over here, the Lord impressed me to serve you communion first. Because every stripe that was placed upon Jesus' back, this broken bread that represents the broken body, was there so that he might be healed. So, I don't know, do you know how to open those? They may need some help. Thank you, Father. I want you to just open it and take that bread. I'm gonna eat with you. And I'd like to, Pastor and Sister Cox, would y'all come on up here? He took the bread and he broke it, representing what was about to be done for him so that Michael could be healed. I don't care what the doctors say. God's got the last word on this. So we're going to appropriate the blessing of that broken back. Amen. The striped back. Did you have something? Were you going to say something? Go ahead. Go ahead. Okay. Go ahead. No, help yourself, sir. So, Father, right now, as we take this prayer, come on, y'all. Come on. It's the prayer of faith that's going to make this thing work. I need you to stretch your faith out here tonight. Father God, we thank you for that body that was broken. And as we eat this bread, we're eating it for Michael right now. That, God, you're going to stretch forth your hand because you're going to get glory out of this. Let those doctors and nurses go home tonight saying, well, I have seen a miracle of God. I've seen a miracle of God tonight. Lord, we're not just saying these words because it's a form. We're asking in faith. And we're appropriating the benefit of this broken body in Jesus' name. Let's eat together. In same manner, Paul said after they had eaten together, he took the cup and he blessed it. Somebody told me this the other night. He blessed it. Actually, that was the bread. He blessed it, and then he broke it, and then he gave it to them. There's a process. There's a process. This man of God here probably going to preach it this week. If he don't, he should. I'm telling you, God knows what he's doing, y'all. Trust him. Put your faith and your hope and your trust in the Lord Jesus tonight. Lord, we thank you for this blood that was shed on Calvary. And Lord, it has never lost its power. And so tonight we drink, Lord, coming into covenant with you that your promise still holds true. In the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you for that blood shed and we drink together now in Jesus' name. Come on. Celebrate his life. Elder, I want you to anoint. Glory to God. Glory to God. Haramaranamaki selamaroshotoya. Jesus. Gelamando shokoranda mama masa. Thank you. Come on, church. Now rejoice. The old church didn't quit praying until they said thank you. Somebody say thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Come on, I want to hear you say it. No Jesus weapon. Name,
no weapon.
Jesus name. Do you believe that?
Jesus.
Come on.
Don't tread on me.
Yes. No weapon.
No.
See, you got it now. Yeah. Just stay right here. Stay right here. Now just release your faith for your prodigals right now. See, this is not calisthenics. This is not spiritual exercise. Come on. This is warfare. And when you get to this spot, it's time to let your requests be made known to God. It's time to decree some things. Tell that devil he ain't having your son, your daughter. Come on. Like I've taken some ground tonight.
Hey,
come
hallelujah.
On. I feel like I've taken some ground tonight. You know, if you could look inside somebody's heart and see their story and how far Christ has brought them, it would cheer you right up. Woo! I'm glad there's power in the name of Jesus. Oh, I'm glad. I'm glad. Oh, say, but I'm glad. Hallelujah. Amen. Well, we're going to, I don't know, I guess we need to do something. It's hard. Anthony will play that until I just tell him, all right, that's enough.
I love it. How you can do, man? I got it.
I love it. Hallelujah. We're going to, now listen, we're going to just shift just a little bit here, and they're going to preach. Then we're going to come back right back here. I said, we're going to come right back here. So, what is the purpose of revival nights? You see, you don't need revival if the thing's already alive. You revive dead things. Now, I'm not saying you're dead, but I'm saying there's some things in you that might need a little life breathed into it. I feel tonight the Spirit of God is stirring up faith. That some of us have got comfortable with the devil pushing on you. And God is going to infuse you with the Word of God that's going to produce a faith that's going to bring an action from heaven. Heaven's going to manifest. We've been fasting and praying this week for God to manifest His Word. You see, in Acts 19, when the Word prevailed, man, everything in that city shifted. I said everything in the city shifted. Witchcraft doesn't have an antidote to revival. Let me say that again. Witchcraft has no antidote to revival. There's no resistance that the enemy can build up against a church that is full of God and full of faith. So tonight, I want you to tap in. You pull on this woman of God as she preaches. And you let God do something in you that He's been wanting to do for a long time. Look at your neighbor and say, God's been wanting to do something in you for a long time. Just get ready, get ready, get ready. Whoa, whoa, whoa. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Whipping my enemy in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Cause no weapon
taking ground
can't form against me.
Taking ground
in Jesus' name.
I'm
taking ground.
I'm taking ground.
I'm taking ground.
Well,
taking ground.
Oh, oh.
Taking ground. I'm taking ground.
Now, you know what? If this bothers you, I don't think you're going to be comfortable in heaven. You need to read. Come on up here, sis. I'm going to preach all night. Come on. You need. In Revelation, it says that the praise that it's going on around that throne is like the sound of many waters. That's not a little gentle creek. That's Niagara Falls thundering, lightning. Amen. It's going to be awesome. Come on, give him another hand clap as the woman of God. Now, I didn't prepare to give them a professional introduction, but this is, don't leave. We're going to keep, but go back there. You have permission to do whatever. We don't have a time frame. But this woman of God's been all over the world preaching the gospel, watching God work, and we are honored. It is our honor to have Susanne Cox fill the pulpit tonight. Come on, give her a hand clap.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Oh, it's such an honor and a blessing to be back with you. Oh, we love this church. We love the Spirit of God here. And it's like I just see people and I just love you because I know your face. And I mean, I know your name, but I do know your face. And, you know, I just feel so. But that song, No Weapon. Go ahead. Let's just come on. No weapon. No weapon. Go ahead. Just sing it.
Bet on me. No weapon.
Oh, my shalom. Shall prosper. There's a lot of weapons being formed right now, but it shall not prosper. And what's down in the well comes up in the bucket. And you better have the Word of God on the inside of you. If you don't have the Word, you don't have any ammunition to come against the works of the enemy. So when that weapon comes against you, you need to stand up and declare, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. It shall not prosper. It shall not prosper. Oh, mashallah. It shall not prosper. Ooh. I was a missionary in India. I was abducted by a taxi driver and taken off in a, and it seemed like I was going to go underground and be sold into trafficking. I was in Southern Asia rescuing little girls from the brothels. And when, you know what? Every morning that I was in Bible college and we would say Psalm 91. Just read Psalm 91. Just start reading it. He that dwelleth in the secret place shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. And so when I was abducted by that taxi driver, you know what came up? When he asked probably the most demon-possessed man I've ever seen in my life. He asked one of the men in the gas station that taxi driver took me to. And he said, kidnap Pesa, yeah, American, how much money do you want for her? He was about to sell me into slave prostitution. I would have gone underground that night and nobody would have ever known where to find me. And tears were streaming down my face and fear was trying to suffocate me. And there was a weapon being formed against me. And I said, Lord, I plead the blood of Jesus over my life and over this man. You said in Psalm 91, you've given your angels charge over me to keep me in all my ways. And when I said that, showed them the angels of God that are encamped around about us. taxi driver jumped in and shundarabaka, I prayed all the way to my doorstep where he dropped me out. Woo! You know what? What's down in the well comes up in the bucket. If I hadn't had the word of God hidden in my heart, I'm telling you, I would have gone underground and nobody would have ever found me again. Our God is an awesome God. Woo! Hallelujah! Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Woo! I thank God for churches that, like your church that's in revival right now, Pastor Brad, Tammy, Wendy, Brother Chuck, I'm telling you, Amy and Anthony. God is using you. We had lunch with this precious couple and their boys today. I'm telling you, the hand of God is on this couple, on this family. The hand of God is on this church. You're blessed to have pastors that let the gifts of the Spirit flow in the altars. Oh, because you know what? We're crying out. We're crying out. It seems the church has lost her vision, her passion, her focus. Where are the miracles? They're right here. Oh, they're right here. Tonight we shall see the fruit of the prayers of the saints, the coming of agreement. Halalabaka. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. God never meant for us to settle for an average, ordinary, mediocre, gut it out for God existence when you got born again. God never wanted us to have that. Woo, I'm telling you, there's victory in Jesus. We get to march around the walls and hear a shout. Us, a child of God shall prosper. Daniel 11:32 says, they that know their God shall be strong and do great exploits for God. I don't know about you, but I want to see the signs and wonders and miracles in these last days. We're living in the end times. You believe it? If you hadn't turned on the news, Israel is our time clock, and the swords are rattling over there right now. Each one of us was born with a purpose and a future and a destiny to fulfill. I guess you could go ahead and sit down. I don't know. I don't know what you want to do. Okay. Woo! Yeah. Each one of us was born with a purpose and a future and a destiny. God has placed passions and desires in each one of our hearts so that we can fulfill kingdom business for these last days. There are kingdom assignments. You were born to do something for the kingdom that only you can do. And nobody can take your place. Nobody can take your place. We have to fulfill our place so that other people can come in to the kingdom of God. So I'm here to fan the flame of revival. Woo! I'm here to fan. Look at it. It says slay. We are giant slayers in the kingdom of God. Woo! We gonna fan the flame. Woo! Let the fires of revival burn in this place. Hallelujah! Let revival fire burn in this place. I'm here to tell you, dream big for God. Nothing is impossible with God. Nothing. And so don't you dare give up. You're not in this alone. God is with us. And if God is for us, who can be against us? Who can be against us? Woo! So God is raising up an army. I love that song that we... God is raising up an army, a remnant for revival. The way is narrow. Not everybody's going to travel this road with us. Not everybody's going to travel the road. It's a narrow road. And as time gets shorter, the road gets more narrow. And I'm here to fan the flame. When a fire turns to embers, what do? Woo, we fan the flame. And all of a sudden, it just burns back up again. Begin to come alive again. It's time. Revival is in the air. So number one, when the church gathers, we find our purpose. The church at large has seemed to have lost her purpose. I dare say we all read The Purpose-Driven Life, right? Rick Warren wrote a book that sold 30 million copies. And I dare say we all read it. But you know what? Then we got all excited about our purpose in life and ministry and doing things for the kingdom of God. And then what happens? Life gets in the way. Life gets busy. We can get so busy just doing stuff that doesn't even matter. Surfing Facebook for hours, and I'm preaching to myself. I'm preaching to myself. Just surfing mindlessly. I mean, when we could be on our face praying, fasting, asking God to shake our nation, because the greater the shaking, the greater the glory. The greater the shaking, the greater the glory. And He's shaking us right now. And so we have come to discover our purpose, because when you get all, we just watch. We got busy doing kids and grandkids and going to football games and running errands and taking kids to cheerleading practice and all that. And we became spiritually dull and apathetic in America while the moral and the spiritual decline kept happening and happening until here we are today. Who would have ever dreamed that we are where we are today? And so I have come to fan the flame of revival, right? And so we need to discover our purpose for two reasons. One, because purpose releases us from the captivity of hopelessness and despair. When you are depressed, the reason you're depressed is because you're inward looking. And if you would get outside of yourself and begin to see other people who are hurting and broken and need the Lord, it helps you get out of that depression. Number two, it helps us fulfill our destiny for the glory of God. The church, He's coming for a glorious church. A glorious church. Are we there yet? See, when we're doing life with God's people in faith and family and church and community, that's when we become like Christ. The enemy tried to shut down the church in 2020. He tried to keep us disconnected. He tried to get us alone in solitary confinement so that we would get depressed and suicidal. And let me tell you, the suicide rate is through the roof right now. I mean, there are people that are hurting and broken, and God has given us the Great Commission. He was giving it to every single one of us, not just the fivefold ministry, not just your pastor, we're not evangelists. We're pastors. We'll always be pastors. Now we're revivalists. I've come to fan the flame of revival. Woo! Hallelujah. But the Great Commission, Matthew 18:19, says, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Mark 16:15, go into all the world and preach the gospel. Preach the good news to every creature. There's some creatures out there. Cast out devils. And when you speak with new tongues, you could take up serpents. And if you drink anything deadly, it will not hurt you. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. They shall recover. Listen, the gospel is good news. The night that I got born again, I was 31 years old, a depressed, suicidal, alcoholic, a drug addict. My life had spiraled out of control. I'd pushed everybody out of my life. And I was driving home from work one day, and I looked over, and there was this huge camp meeting sign out front. And I thought, camp meeting? I wonder what that means. Must mean summer camp. I didn't know any Pentecostal lingo at Nana's church. And so I went home, and I took a nap. And when I woke up, I knew I had to be at that church. I had to be there. And I pulled in the parking lot. And I watched all these people coming in suits and ties and dresses and Bibles. And I thought, you know, this is just another place that I don't belong. I could be in a room full of people, and I felt like I never fit in anywhere. And I was about to crank my car and drive away, and it was like a hand pushed me out of my car. And I walked up the steps to that church. And I didn't want to go to church on Tuesday night. Who goes to church on Tuesday night? Same people that come out on Friday night. Well, woo. It was an Assembly of God church. And I walked up the steps to that church, and there was a little greeter standing at the door. She knew she was on kingdom assignment that night. And she looked at me and she said, honey, are you by yourself? And I said, yes, ma'am. I don't know the first thing about an Assembly of God church. I just know when I woke up, I had to be here. And she said, praise the Lord. And I went, oh, no, I've heard about people like you. I think we had an Avon lady like that one time. And she said, come on, you can come and sit with me. And so as I was sitting there and I was watching all these people, I mean, it's like camp meeting. They were jumping up and down and hooting and rooting and shouting and hanging from the chandeliers. And I thought, you know, I kind of like this place. It kind of looks familiar. And here comes the pastor with probably one of the most eloquent speakers you'll ever hear in your life. And it was Dr. Mark Rutland. And he came out, and he was a missionary at the time. He had gone on to be the president of Southeastern University and Oral Roberts University. And he came out, and he shared a simple message on the love of God. He didn't say, you dirty, rotten sinner, who whatever you did last night, you're going to go straight to hell for that. No. He preached good news. He preached good news. And he said, you could be here tonight and you wish you had never even been born. And I thought, that's me. Since I was 10 years old, I had heard those voices telling me, nobody loves you. Nobody cares about you. You might as well kill yourself because everybody else would be better off if you did. I had tried drug overdoses. I had tried running my car off a bridge. I had tried loading a 38 pistol, and I got so drunk that I passed out. And he's there telling me, you may be here tonight and you wish you had never been born, but I'm here to tell you, you can be born again. And I'm like, what? He said, you can be born again. You can be washed clean by the blood of Jesus. You can stand before a holy God as if you had never sinned. And I had tears streaming down my face, and I thought, how have I been raised in church most of my life and I have never even heard this? And he said, if you want to bow your heads and pray a simple prayer like I pray. He was about to give the altar call. And my legs jumped up. I ran to the front. I had never seen an altar call in my life. And I knelt down and I said, God, if this is real, I want it. I want to change. I want a new beginning. I want to start over. Woo! And that night, September 14th, 1993, at 9:30 p.m. at an altar about right there, I gave my heart to Jesus and became a new creation in Christ Jesus. Woo! That's what revival is all about. That's what happens when people come in and the Spirit of God is in the house. Woo! Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. So, woo! So that's the big picture. And then there's a more defined purpose. Jeremiah 29:11 says, I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. And if you'll seek me with your whole heart, you'll find me. And so I found out that God had a plan for my life. But first I had to let go of all the pain and all the resentment, because all I had done for years was stuff the monster with alcohol and drugs and worldly things. And God was saying, drop the chains. Drop the chains of unforgiveness. Drop the chains so you can be free to walk in everything that I have for you. And so I had to gather with the people of faith. My little women of faith, my pioneers of faith surrounded me. They just surrounded, they took me in on a mission. Because I came in with big hair, red lips, and mini skirts up to here. And they said, here, honey, here is you a Bible. Why don't you start reading it tonight? And I said, okay. Remain teachable all the days of your life. They told me that the word of God generates life, and it creates faith, and it heals hurts, and it builds character, and it scares the daylights out of the devil. Jesus taught us how to fight the devil with "it is written." It is written. We got to get back to knowing what the word of God says. And so they just began to surround me and challenge me. And because we need each other, Ecclesiastes 4:9 says, two are better than one because they have a good return on their work. If one falls down, his friend can help him up. But how tragic it is for one to fall and have no one to pick him up. We are in this together. You are not alone. You have a church family. You have a pastor. You have prayer warriors all around to help you in this journey. Deuteronomy 32:30, if one can put 1,000 to flight, two can put 10,000 to flight. That's God's multiplication system right there. And God designed us to live in community. And you say, well, I'm so busy, Susanne. You just don't know how busy I am. Yes, I do. But God calls us to come gather in his presence. You can gather in Bible studies or church. You know, we have a once a month ladies' night out so that women can invite their unsaved ladies that they work with, so that women can see that you can have a good time and not have to drink to do it, you know? Where it's time to leave the things of the world, right? Yes. Prayer groups, running groups. I'm a runner, and you know what? The Holy Ghost is going somewhere in these last days, and we better learn how to keep pace with him, because he knows where he's going, and he will get us to the finish line on time. It's a good way to hold each other accountable. Acts 20:24 says, what matters most to me, Paul, this is the Apostle Paul, what matters most to me is to finish what God started, the job the Master Jesus gave me of letting everyone I meet know all about this incredibly extravagant generosity of God. We need to never lose the wonder of your salvation. You have a story to tell. God will put people in your path to hear your story. You don't have to have the whole Bible memorized. You just have to tell them what you were like before and what you're like now, because Jesus changed your life. And ask for divine appointments wherever you go. We were at Chili's restaurant today. And I went into the bathroom, and there was a lady in there, and she was very rattled, and there was an insulin syringe laying on the bathroom countertop. I have two diabetic, type 1 diabetic grandsons, and so I knew what it was. And she came out, and she was so disheveled, and she was fearful, fear on her face. And I said, is that your insulin syringe? She said, oh, honey, my insulin pump is broken. And she said, I was so thankful that I at least had one shot with me that I carry with me. And I just said, I know all about it. And I put my hand on her back and I said, Jesus, God, you just let her insulin be normal in Jesus' name. Just touch her body right now. And she said, oh, thank you, thank you. And then she ran out the bathroom door. But you know what? It was a divine appointment. It happened that quick. I could have washed my hands and just said, there's an insulin syringe. I got new and walked on out the door. But I waited. God had me wait just for a split second for that divine encounter. Oh, Jesus. Let that woman's pancreas come alive right now in Jesus' name. Let a miracle happen. When we lay hands on the sick, they shall recover. In Jesus' name. I love how God can take the broken shards of glass from our shattered lives and turn it into a beautiful stained glass window. Oh, he's the God of the second chance. He's the God of resurrection power. There is nothing or no one too hard for the Lord. Okay, the second thing that happens when the church gathers, and I am here to fan the flame, is the passion. The passion comes. It's time to get our fire back. Passion for souls. Passion for your marriage. Passion for your prodigals. We declare the prodigal is coming home. The prodigal is coming home. We believe the first wave of this revival that's coming to America is the prodigals coming home. We've been seeing it for years. God spoke to Ron and he screamed it out in a church service, and we have seen it happen and happen. Messages and inboxes and phone calls. My prodigal has come home. My prodigal has come home. Passion for your church. According to Webster's dictionary, passion means compelling emotion, strong feeling of love, or it could even be lust, enthusiasm, or desire for something. An outburst of enthusiasm. One of the definitions in the Webster's dictionary is the sufferings of Christ on the cross. Mel Gibson reintroduced us to the passion of the Christ. It's hard to watch. The sufferings that Jesus took for us, for you and for me. So that he tore the curtain so that we could come to the Father, directly to the Father, directly to the Father. Jesus endured that which was outside of him, the suffering, the storm of torment, the agony of inflicted pain on him. He endured it patiently. Therefore, the word passion and patience are tied together at the foot of the cross. Passion and patience. You see, passion is neutral, but the things we pursue are not. Passion can be a good thing or a bad thing. The choice is ours, what we pursue. The Bible says, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. See, your heart follows what you treasure, not your treasures follow your heart. Your heart follows what you treasure. What is it? Is it my beloved? Oh, my goodness, that song is so beautiful. My beloved. I just fell on my knees. I'm like, God, you are so beautiful. You're more beautiful than 10,000. My heart follows my treasure. Passion can be negative. Samson. His passion led him to lust and sexual immorality with Delilah. Samson taught us that we can't fight the Philistines by day and sleep with them by night. You got to choose this day whom you will serve. Balaam's passion was for money. The Pharisees' passion was for religion. Peter's passion was for vengeance. Or passion can be positive. Moses' passion was for the people of Israel to walk in freedom that God had given them to go into the promised land. Nehemiah's passion was to build the wall. Paul's passion was to plant new churches and see souls come into the kingdom. So when we gather, you begin to search your heart. We've been praying, God, search our hearts. To see what is really inside of us. What is the passion that fires your soul? I have a passion to rescue and restore broken girls in Southern Asia. That's what fans the flame in my heart every single day of my life. passion is more caught than taught. It's contagious. It causes you to shout, no reserve, no retreat, no regrets. No reserve, no retreat, no regrets. Jeremiah said, there's a fire shut up in my bones. Elijah passionately cried out, let the God that answers my fire be God. My husband is 76 years old, and he's more on fire for God than I've ever seen him before in his life. More on fire. You can't just get bitter and hang your harp on the willow tree when the enemy begins, to, you know, there's some things this side of heaven we'll never understand. How do you keep the fire of God when the wife that you had for, he took care of an invalid wife for 25 years. And when she passed away, I came home on furlough from the mission field, and we met and got married. And then 7 years ago, his beautiful Tiffany, he's got two daughters that he raised by himself. They send him Mother's Day cards. He raised them because Glenda was an invalid. And then 7 years ago, Tiffany called. She's the youth pastors of our church, she and Jeremy, with three beautiful children. And said, Daddy, I have my mother's disease. I have Huntington's disease. What do you do when you get a report like that? Do you hang your harp on the willow tree like the children of Israel did when the Babylonians would taunt them and say, let's hear you sing the song of the Lord now in a strange land. And they hung their harp on the willow tree and they refused to sing the song of the Lord. Not us, not Tiffany. She could sing the roof off the building. And she would continue. While other people sat around, she would sit in her wheelchair and she would fight to stand up and praise the living God. She would fight to stand up when everybody else would just sit in apathy while the worship was going on. She's in heaven now. Some things we'll never understand. I don't know why. But we can't let the fire go out. We've got to keep fanning the flame of revival in our own life, in our own life, in our own heart. Because it's never God. You said it right there. I don't know why Tiffany didn't get healed, but what I do know is Isaiah 53 says he was wounded for her transgressions. He was bruised for her iniquities. The chastisement of her peace was upon him, and with his stripes she was healed. She was born again. We will see her again. This life is a blip on the radar screen. Ha! Woo! Hallelujah. So fan the flame. Woo! My prayer is not let me burn out for Jesus. I don't want to finish in a pile of ashes. Listen, I was born again in the fires of camp meeting service. I refuse to die in the ashes. Woo! My prayer is let me burn on. May the flame on the altar of my heart never go out until I see my Jesus face to face. Woo! Many people are disappointed with the way their lives are going. They thought that things would have gone different. What about your divine purpose? The evidence of knowing God is not so great in your life anymore. Really? I'm here to fan the flame. God's plan is always ready for you right there. To be passionate about something, you have to be willing to suffer for it. Listen, we can't get so far inside the four walls of the church that we can't hear the cry of the world. We can't come in here and just have revival for ourselves. This is for them. This is for the harvest. We need to be a lean, mean harvesting machine in these last days. Woo! Yes. Amen. So we have to be passionate. Oh, passionate separates those who make a successful ascent from those who don't. The real dividing line is, as long as you believe you're doing meaningful things, you can keep going. You can persevere. You can keep going, regardless of how people are talking about you behind your back. If you haven't read The Bait of Satan lately by John Bevere, you need to pull that book out and start reading it again. Because the enemy is trying to keep us at odds with each other, keep us offended at each other. We refuse to take that bait. We're fanning the flame of revival. And God is saying, check your heart. Are you offended? Let it go. Drop the chains of unforgiveness. So what inspires you? What do you care about? What is it that, what's the legacy that you want to leave? What can you do better than anybody else? That sweet lady that made my gift basket for here, Miss Margaret. Whoo, that woman is a gift from God. She knows how to do. There is a, my gift basket, yeah. Ours. Okay. Step out of your comfort zone. Do something that you've never done before. Just take one step. And God will meet you there to do something for Him. Emotions are contagious. All right. So I'm here to fan the flame. Yes, I am. Passion is a God-given capacity to fervently attach ourselves to a cause or a mission or an idea or an area of ministry. Overextend yourself and be able to, how did I get to India? You know what? I just heard the area director stand at a camp meeting on a platform and say, my heart's desire is to see 1 million daughters of India at the marriage supper of the Lamb. And I said, oh God, if you will use me, please let me go. I'll go. And he did. And I didn't know how to be a missionary. But God said, see, the anointing is not on a person so much as it is on a God-given assignment. The anointing is not on a person. Listen, when God said, go to India, I was not anointed to go to India. I stepped into that God-given assignment, and the anointing was there to do everything that I knew how to do. I didn't know how, but He knew how. He didn't send me. He brought me. He was there with me the whole time. Glory to God. So what is your passion? What rings your spiritual bell? Is it the lost or the unborn or the poor or the oppressed or the unreached people groups? Is it the addicted, prisoners, marriage ministry, youth ministry, children's ministry, sex trafficking? How, you know, you just got to find out what rings your spiritual bell and fan the flame and let that vision rise up in your heart. I don't know. I'm just going to go on. So people need purpose. People need passion. And when the church gathers, we become people of power. Woo! It's time to fan the flame in the altars. It's time to see the power of God in action. It's time to get the Holy Ghost back in the church. The church in this generation. And we travel. We see it. The church has woven the wings of the Holy Spirit so tight that He cannot even move anymore. It's all about an organized service. That's what I love about your pastor. Let's just have church. Let's see what the Holy Ghost has to say. Let's do what the Holy Ghost wants to do. Not an agenda, not man's agenda. The Holy Ghost wants His church back. He wants His church back. Let Him soar. Let Him fly. Let Him move. We are a Pentecostal people who must have the gifts of the Spirit in these last days. I'm not just crying out for a move of God, but a habitation. Not just a visitation, a habitation of the presence and the power of God. I'm more hungry for God than I've ever been in my life. We can't afford to live any longer without the power of God manifesting in our lives. How do we manifest the power of God? Through prayer. James 5:16, the effectual, fervent prayers of a righteous man avails much, making tremendous power available. Tremendous power. That word is dunamis power. Dynamite. Boom. I mean, it's dynamite power. That is right here on the inside of us. Let the power of prayer. I'm telling you, we've been to some churches where the coffee bar is the hottest thing going in the church. It's time to get the prayer rooms on fire again. Yes. Prayer transforms. It gets the results. We're going to see the results. I'm telling you, sister, we're seeing the results. How did I get saved? Nobody in my family was saved. I wasn't even looking for God, but He was looking for me. Let me tell you how I got saved. It was the pioneers of faith, the women of God in the prayer room, what we call the boiler room. On their knees in the afternoon of September 14th, 1993, saying, God, send them in from the north, south, east, and west. Let them come down this highway. Let them come into this church and get radically saved. Oh, God, let them know you. Let them know you. That's the power of prayer. I wasn't even thinking about going to church. I was thinking about taking my life. And the little women of God and the prayer warriors were on their faces calling out to God to send them in. And I came in. I was the first of my family to get saved. God is so faithful. Prayer transforms. It gets results. Number two, understand spiritual warfare. This is spiritual warfare. We are in the battle for a generation who is lost and dying, who doesn't even know God. Doesn't even know God. It's like going on a mission field when you go into Walmart. You know, it's like people don't even know God. We must manifest the power of God through praise and worship. When you make up your mind to praise God, regardless of your circumstances, regardless of the storm you're in, regardless of the pain you're in, Paul and Silas sang praises in the midnight hour, and it broke the chains of bondage off of every prisoner in there. Whew. The power of God. The devil can't stand the power of God, the presence of God. And when you get on fire for God, slay. We're giant slayers. Who was it? Amy Simple McPherson? They said, you don't seem to be afraid of one devil. She said, I eat giants for breakfast every morning. She said, I ain't scared of the devil. She's a slayer. Woo! Psalm 149 says, praise binds the enemy. Praise until you get the victory. Power is flowing. The Holy Ghost is wanting to move and manifest. Stand to your feet. Acts 1:8. But you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Woo! Power to be a witness. Power to say, here I am, Lord. Send me. Ignite my passion. Restore my purpose. Help me find I'm ready now. Fan the flame. Who would say I'm ready to be a carrier of the torch of Almighty God so that I can change my nation? Who's ready to say I'm ready to scorch the devil's territory? Who's ready to say, set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain and I can't control? I want you to come on down. Who's ready for fresh fire? Who's here that doesn't know the Lord that would say, Susanne, tonight's my night for my miracle? Woo! Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Oh, a fresh fire! A fresh fire! A fresh fire! Mashallah, shallah. I'm here to fan the flame. I'm here to fan the flame, baby. Oh, God's got you, Ashley, my sweet girl.
No weapon Jesus' name. wants you just to listen to me for a moment. Men that have served God for a good while, there's something going on. I'm going to tell you something. I can see it. You remember the miracle of the dry bones. But now listen. I don't know how it happened, but nothing is drier than that once had life. They were once an army. They wasn't dead from the beginning. They forfeited the life. Now listen. The prophet, I don't know exactly how it happened, but I saw something there. The prophet of God was not free to prophesy to the four winds until the bones decided to come together. On the day of Pentecost, they were in one accord. You see, when it talks about the power of God falling on this generation, some of our preachers have got it all wrong. They think they're just talking about we need to make the church more attractive to the younger generation. Listen, the generation that is alive when Jesus splits the skies, no matter what age you are this generation. Now listen, I've never had this happen. I want the older men that love God, you've been walking with God, because I want to lay hands on you. The thing that's missing in the church that sustains revival. You don't want just to shoot up on Jesus and it's over with, do you? How many want a move of God that is sustained till Jesus comes? Now listen, I want the older men, I'm going to lay hands on you, and I want God to raise up spiritual fathers. Older men, would you come and stand right here, and I want to lay hands on you. It doesn't matter. I'm not, when I say older, I'm talking about you've walked with God for a while. You're a part of I want you to stand right here, and I want to lay hands on you. Come right on up. Men, and if you're here, and maybe you're not totally involved, but you want God to use you as an older man. When I'm saying older, I'm not talking about my age. I'm talking about in maturity in the things of God. And then I want to lay hands on you. And I'm going to ask, how many know that Elisha needed an Elijah? I would have never made it. I'd have never made it as a welfare kid if I didn't have some spiritual fathers in my life. Look at this man right there. I want you to lift up your hand. Wants to touch the deepest intimacies in you that you can't even reach by yourself. Amen. So I lay hands on you. Power of God, come on this man. Come into this man. Thank you.
We've got some youth from Shady Oaks. Is that right? Y'all still here? Amen. Y'all come on up here. Come line up right here. Glory to God. Thank you for being here, your youth pastors. Glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's pray over this youth group from a neighboring church, Pastor, from Shady Oaks Church. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, guys. Y'all circle up over here. Give me some anointed folk. Anybody anointed in here? On fire. Glory to God.
Oh,
Yeah. Come on. Boy, hadn't this been wonderful? Good night. No, no, we ain't doing that. We're not doing that. This is where we've always got to. I'm ready for something fresh tonight. Come on. God's done great things tonight, but I laid my hands on this young man over here. The Lord whispered to me, you'll find your limits really quick, but you'll never find his. There is no limit to this God. There's no ceiling. There's no, well, I can only take you this far. He'll take you as far as you're willing to go. He will lift you. There is no limit to where this God wants to take you tonight. So press. Come on. Come on. Press. 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 Just play it for a minute. Jesus. Hallelujah. This generation, God is placing a mantle. He's mantling you tonight. He's putting a calling and an anointing upon your life. To speak, he is going to deposit in you the key that is going to unlock your generation. Talking to you young folks here, God is going to release the keys to you to unlock the secret to reaching your generation. Come on, church, I need you to pray with me tonight. I want you to agree with me for this generation. God is going to deposit it in you. He will take you as far as you're willing to go. As far as you're willing to go. Radabakasata. Jesus, we come against the gender confusion. Come on. We bind that lying spirit right now. We bind a spirit of gender confusion, of homosexuality. We bind that lie of hell. We come against the spirit of suicide. Hopelessness, worthlessness, cutting in the name of Jesus. These are the children of the Most High God. My God, let us build them. Let us pour into them. Jesus. Father, give them the keys to the kingdom. Rest. Rest upon them tonight, Master. Rest upon them tonight. Lift your hands. Lift your hands. Rest upon them tonight. My God, rest. Woo! Rest. Rest. Oh, come on. Come on. Honey, it's yours. It's yours. Signs and wonders. Gifts flowing. Gifts flowing. Radabakasata. The devil is a liar. The devil is a liar. You don't listen to him no more. You are a daughter of the Most High God. His favor is upon you. His love surrounds you. The devil is a liar. And what this woman of God preached tonight was just penetrating and tearing down the shackles and the strongholds that hell has built around your life. God brought you to the kingdom for such a time as this. This is your moment. This is your hour. Jesus. Come on, just lift your hands. Lift your hands and let the Holy Spirit cut. Yeah, break it. Break it. Break it. Yeah, freedom. Freedom. Freedom from the lie. Freedom from the lie. Jesus. Come on, baby. Come on, baby. Go there. Go there. Y'all pray over that woman. Come here, sister. Come on. He doesn't have your answer. Jesus doesn't have all the answers. He is the answer. Come on. You're not looking for a thing. You're looking for a person. Wow. You know, God will wreck you in order to save you.
Holy, 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 you're holy.
How many of you remember the night you got saved? Or the day you got saved? I love what Suzanne's down here showing that young lady. You look at the time. Mark the time. This is when Jesus started working a new thing in your life.
Hallelujah.
How many of you remember the night or the day you got filled with the Holy Ghost? You remember when that happened? Isn't that awesome? But you can't live on yesterday's roast beef. You need something fresh from His altar tonight. Come on, I want you to go home full, because your city, your community, your family needs you to be on fire. Fan that thing into flame. Fan that thing into flame. Now, if you hadn't been prayed for, maybe they're not us. We didn't hit your thing. There's room up here. We'll pray for you. We'll be here till midnight, because it's Friday night. We got nowhere to be but in God's house. So come on, let's pray. Tomorrow night at 6 o'clock, we'll be right here. 6 o'clock. Get here early.
Thank you.
quiet down just a minute. I want y'all to meet a young lady here tonight. This is Kyra. I don't know if I'm saying that right or not. Kyra, all right. Kyra, what did Jesus do for you tonight?
He set me free.
Yes. He set me free. The power of the gospel, y'all. Now, you need to go home to your home church. You need to tell your pastor what Jesus did. You need to get baptized. You need to hang with these folks. They love you. So does Jesus.
Glory!
I love that.
Beautiful.
More? Oh, Well, here, come on up here, baby. Man, y'all just come and sold. Well, nothing happens without prayer. What's your name, honey?
Maddie.
Maddie, what did Jesus do for you tonight, Maddie?
He set me free.
Huh? He set me free. Jesus. Woo! Isn't that beautiful? Now, what Susanne did while ago to Kyra, I saw her down there showing her that watch. You mark this day. This is a big deal. God has started something, and he's not going to quit. He ain't going to quit. He won't let up.
Wow.
You tell your pastor, y'all have a water baptism service. Get full of the Holy Ghost. Get the fire of God.
Hey.
What you looking at? What'd Jesus do for you today? Huh? Huh? He forgave you. Amen. You won't ever forget this. He's good like that, isn't he? Come on, give me five. Glory! You all right? Sure? We can just do this all night long. Did you get something down here a while ago? Did you get something down here a while ago? What'd you get?
Healing in my lungs.
Healing in your lungs. Well, praise God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for bringing these guys here tonight. Y'all blessed us. Amen. Now, Pastor Ron, I wanted me to tell you, so tomorrow night, Pastor Ron at 6 o'clock, Sunday morning, we're going to hear this little lady again. I forget what her name is. We're just going to try to get her excited a little bit. And then Sunday night, Pastor Ron's going to be preaching again to wrap us up. So three more services, tomorrow night at 6, Sunday morning at 10:30, Sunday night at 6. Please invite your friends. You see what God's doing. You bring the need to him. He'll meet it. Amen. Glory. We're going to keep going on here, but I'm going to put this mic down. Y'all have fun.
Without generations and your family and your children and their children and their children, may his favor be upon you. For 1,000 generations and your family and your children and their children.
Children, may his favor be upon you and
Of my King, hallelujah. I can can hear the Spirit calling me. He's calling, awake up, child. It's your time to shine, for you were born for such a time as this. He's calling, awake up, child. It's your time to shine, for you were born for such a time as this.
Shake history. Not hidden. There's never been a moment you were forgotten. You are not hopeless. Though you have been broken, your innocence stolen. I hear you whisper underneath your breath. I hear there is no distance, it cannot be covered over and over, you're not defenseless.
shelter, I'll be your armor. I hear you whisper underneath your breath. I hear your SOS, your SOS. I will send out.
Sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, oh sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burden. sinner be still. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow.